I pitch this story, call it Story A, The Lid. And these guys say, "Are you sure it's a book? Because it sounds like a podcast." Well, it could be. I say it could be a podcast, could be a podcast and a book. But I'll tell you something. If you want a podcast, I have a story for a podcast. So I pitch Story B, call it The Device. I say, what's cool about this idea is that it has elements of Story A, The Lid. Chronologically, it comes after Story A, but I would be telling Story B first. So these elements would foreshadow what would be coming in the book. This is the podcast I was 24 hours away from recording here this weekend. The story I was going to tell over 12 episodes, an entire season, practically a whole year with just one story. And I was going to drop elements. Every episode would have an element of the book in it, like surreptitiously hiding. And so the guy goes, we're talking about Story B now. He goes, "Are you sure that's a podcast? Because that sounds like a really good book. I like that book better than the first book." So, Story C. This is who killed Teresa. Story C was just research. I was probably gonna end up putting it in as two paragraphs in Story A, The Lid. It also has elements that reflect and foreshadow and comment. And I'm in no hurry to tell this story. I got a lot of information on this case, and but I haven't quite figured out, how to land the plane. I haven't completely worked out the staging. It has all the elements you've been accustomed to hearing here on Who Killed Teresa. Set in Quebec, unsolved murder, criminal investigative failures. Quebec, yeah. Quebec lives in this, I found, discovered. This is an evolving idea for me. And it brings me no comfort in saying it, but I'm going to say it. Quebec lives in this echo chamber of delusion. I mean, if you think the fake news era in the States is bad, Quebec has been living in a version of that landscape ever since Champlain planted a fleur-de-lis right on the mountain. And what strikes me about this case is how the narrative has changed over the last 50 years. There is now a very controlled version of this story, and most of the elements that would help to solve the case, they've been dropped. I don't buy the versions of this story peddled by the police and the press. I don't buy the current narrative that is posted on the Sûreté du Québec's website. I don't buy any of the press information from 1969. This is the 1969 unsolved murder of Teresa Martin. Septembre 1969, Teresa Martin, 15 ans, revient du cinéma des Galeries d'Anjou en soirée, accompagnée de deux amis en autobus à l'intersection Saint-Michel et Henri Bourassa. Teresa quitte ses copains pour prendre un transfert. Vers 3 heures du matin, son corps fut retrouvé en position assise dans le stationnement de la taverne de Vieux Cyprès sur le boulevard Henri Bourassa. La jeune victime a soigneusement été déposée à cet endroit par le ou les suspects. Toute information pouvant aider à résoudre ce crime peut être communiquée à la centrale de l'information criminelle de la Sûreté du Québec au 1-800-659-4264. Teresa Martin, I may have been aware of this. I was aware of this picture. I know her face. I know the picture. I must have seen it by trolling the list of cold cases on the Sûreté du Québec's website. But before Christmas, a woman contacted me on my French Facebook page and asked if I knew the case and could I do a little work around it. So I did, and I got back to her and I told her what I thought had happened. And she said, that doesn't make sense. That's not what the police said. That's not what the media said. And I said, well, I know, but that's what I say. And that's the way it is. And I said, did you know her? Did you know the family? She said, no, but I grew up in Montreal North, in around the same neighborhood. As I think she said, she was a little younger than Teresa Martin, and so she was familiar with the story. But you know, like so many, she had lost the narrative thread of it. She recalled it, but over time, you know, the story had gotten massaged and slowly, as these things do, all the truth got sucked out of it and was reduced down into mythologizing, which can happen after, particularly after 50 years. It gets highly mythologized and, excuse me, becomes, you know, moves into the realm of lore. I find the corridor of 50 years really interesting because it's on the cusp of, you know, it's just about to go outside the boundaries of collective memory. People from that era, it's a lot of bird activity right now, excuse me. I've become like a noise interference germaphobe here, which is unfortunate. I should just let it rip, but nevertheless, hopefully we'll clean some of this up in the post edit. But I've become really interested in the 60s, as I said, because you know, the adults from that era, anybody over 20 is now 70, right? So they're pushing it. If they smoke and drank all their life, they're probably already dead now. They probably died in their 60s. And so you're kind of left with the children, right? Who kind of grew up with these stories from the neighborhood, and your memory is beginning to think, did this really happen or not? Which is an interesting sandbox in which to play those frontiers of memory. I don't know if I can make this turn. I was talking to my brother about this. I don't know if anybody has made like a memory palace. I've done it to memorize large portions of material, where I think the traditional way of doing it is you think of a castle, right? And you put a different memory in each room in the castle. So something is in the dungeon and something is in the Rapunzel Tower, I don't know, something like this. But the notions of cataloging rooms is very interesting. A lot of my dreams revolve around rooms. So like I think a lot of you, particularly if you've moved around a lot, so my home in New Brunswick, where my parents no longer live, occupies a lot of my time. My home in Pierrefonds, where I grew up with Teresa, occupies a lot of my time, moving from room to room, seeing what I can remember and what's lost. What's lost is my brother and I were talking about one of our grandparents' homes. For some reason, and you kind of walked. It was a farmhouse, and you walked in across like this rock gravel sub basement. You came in through like almost like this cave, and then came into the laundry room. And through the laundry room was the kitchen, which was the kind of the main living area. To the left was the traditional living room fireplace. There was a parlor in the back, and to get to the parlor, it was circular, right? So you could get to the parlor through the living room, which had a staircase leading to the second floor. You could also get to the parlor through the kitchen. If you continued through the kitchen, you'd get into the you'd get where the piano was and this kind of stuff. But he remembered that along the way through the kitchen on the left was a door that went down to a basement. And he was like, do you remember that? And I hadn't. He was like, no, they kept all their preserves down there. Remember, he was like, Nan pickled, and he was like, and Mac kept his tobacco down there. And when he was ready, he'd bring the tobacco up, and he had this rolling kit to roll the cigarettes. He'd sprinkle the tobacco in, and then the machine would cut the cigarettes. So once every 2 or 3 days, he'd go through this process of making my grandmother and him the cigarettes for a period, put them in this box he kept in the living room by the fireplace. I had that memory was lost, right? That door was closed until my brother acknowledged there was a door there. Once he opened the door, I could see it. The rickety wooden stairs down, the rock next to the walls as you went down there. I think there were wooden shelves with preserves on them along the wall down. That may be true. That may actually be my parents' house. It's in New Brunswick. And I'm conflating the two, right? But this, these notions of doors and memory, very powerful stuff. I'm not going to go all Freud on you. You get my point. Doors and transportation. More and more, I've become really kind of obsessed on transportation corridors and methods of transportation. We've had a lot of cases that that have involved that, right? To some extent, the Natalie Boucher case in Longueuil, where she takes the metro to the Longueuil terminus and then transfers to at the terminus to the bus, right? The Joanne Dorion case, she's on a bus in Ahuntsic. Melanie Cabé, certainly on a bus. The bookend case to the Dorion case is the Chantal Tremblay case, where the same night she's on a bus. A bus from like Laval to the Henri Bourassa metro station, and that's where we lose sight of her. So these nexuses of transportation are interesting, and I bring it up because Teresa Martin was last on a bus, right? And it got me thinking. There's a section in Wish You Were Here, if you've read the book. If you haven't read the book, it doesn't matter, because I talked about it on a podcast where I had this dream, right, where I got lost in Montreal, and so these two guys ostensibly said they'd help me, and they take me to these woods, and they say, you know, it's sort of like the Goodfellas moment, just come back here. Hey, Karen, come back here. it was one of those things. Come on into the woods, fella. So I go into the woods, and slowly as I go into the woods, I kind of transmorph into my young self. And then I realize I'm a like one of these young girls. And I think the words I used was being hunted. And it's interesting, the difference. So that dream is in the paragraph in the book, and the difference between the description in the book and the description on whatever podcast it was, it had been severely edited out, because when I originally wrote it, the editors were really concerned, because I was writing from the point of view of like a girl being one of these girls. And what's the term? They thought I would be... That it was appropriation, and they were concerned that I was appropriating the place of a woman. So I had to really kind of tone that down in the writing. Welcome to the Canadian publishing industry. But I bring that up because I don't think either in the book or in the podcast, I bothered to mention, that dream had an origin that went further back. It actually began, that dream, at the Montreal Dorval Airport. And if you know anything about Dorval, it is, in fact, a transportation network. If you go from the airport to Dorval Circle, which is literally, a circular road. It's a roundabout. The train station is there. And in the dream, I traversed from the airport, with a bag, to the Dorval train station, to a bus, to a taxi stand, like in Lachine or something like that. And that's the point where I met these two guys, these two unsavory characters. The nature of dreams. So one of the questions this woman asked me, she said, is it true that they went to a movie that night? And I said, well, that's what we're told. The scaffolding of the story is September 12th, 1969. 14-year-old, she's 14, Teresa Martin, she goes to the movies with friends, with two friends. They go to the mall to see this movie. We're told they take the bus. We're told on the way home, Teresa gets off the bus to make a transfer back to her home where she lives with her parents, and she never makes it home. That's kind of the story. So she wanted to know, did she go to the movies? I said, I think we're told that. So I looked into it. And the movie they go to see is interesting. They go to see The Magus, the 1968 adaptation of the John Fowles novel, The Magus. I think the Fowles novel was released in the mid-60s, something like that. And it's adapted right into this movie that you've never heard of. I can guarantee you, you've never heard of this film. It stars Mike O'Kane, Anthony Quinn, Candice Bergen, and Anna Karina. And I'm just gonna read you the Wikipedia plot here, because it's really good. A young Englishman who has taken a teaching position on the Greek island of Fraxos following the previous instructor's suicide. It's a chance for Nicholas to sample a different surroundings and opportunity to escape from a relationship with his emotionally unstable lover, Anne. At first, Nicholas's life on Fraxos is uneventful but peaceful. However, he soon becomes involved with a reclusive man named Maurice Conscious. Get it? who owns an estate on the opposite side of the island and has a beautiful young woman named Lily as his companion. On being introduced to the couple, Nicholas's life begins to unravel, and he tries to find out who the mysterious Conscious really is. Is he a psychiatrist, a film producer, a Nazi sympathizer, or a magician who controls the lives and destinies of those around him? Nicholas quickly begins to lose his grip on reality, sinking deeper into Conscious's game. During visits to Conscious's estate, Nicholas has a series of experiences which gradually become more unexpected and bizarre. Many are related to past events from Conscious's life. Ultimately, these events begin happening off the estate as well as at unexpected times and places, raising questions as to how much power and control Conscious can actually exercise over others' lives. The story climaxes with a trial directed by Conscious, with Nicholas and many others participating. here's this movie. So Anthony Quinn is back again, right? He's back on a Greek isle. You have a very young Candice Bergen. She barely knew what she was doing as an actress, you know, in the 70s. I can't imagine. 60 and poor Michael Caine. There's some howlers here. I think Michael Caine's like, oh, I didn't know what I was doing. There was something. He says, Caine described it as one of the worst films he had ever been involved in, along with Ashanti and The Swarm. Bergen said, I didn't know what I was supposed to do. Nobody told me. I couldn't put together a semblance of a performance. But the best is Peter Sellers, the actor Peter Sellers, when once asked on what changes he would make in his life if he had, if Peter Sellers had the opportunity to do it all over again, and he replied, "I would do everything exactly the same, except I wouldn't see the magus."
The game he plays is love. The game is desire. The game is tender. The game is terror. The vicious game the magus plays is not a game, but life itself. Or is it death?
There's a trailer for the magus. I'll put up on the website, theresaallore.com, theresaallore.com. I don't know why they call it the magus. The magus is real. The magus is mystery. The magus is love. I don't know. I always knew it as the magus. And it's interesting. There's a podcast called Behind the Screams, which is about horror. You know, it's about horror movies, and I guested on it back in the fall to discuss another John Fowles adaptation, The Collector. What I would say is a much better book and a fantastic movie. Starring Terrence Stamp and Samantha Egger from Cronenberg, The Brood fame. The Collector has been very, very actually influential on a series of serial killers, and that's what I was purportedly there to kind of discuss. But Fowles was very, you know, most people know John Fowles from the French Lieutenant's Woman and the book and the film. Very, very popular in the 70s, kind of forgotten now. Now, you know, what's interesting about that is, so why does Teresa Martin, why do these girls choose the magus, right? Well, in French, it had a different title. It was called Pervert Games. Jeux perverse. Pervert Games. If it was, in fact, her friends that Teresa was with, they went to see Pervert Games. And I can imagine why. Look, this is a 14-year-old girl, right? I cannot believe a 14-year-old, very French girl, was aware of who Michael Caine or Anthony Quinn was. They went because the title was Pervert Games. Whoever went, that's why they went, right? I'm not judging that. I've read The Magus. I know The Magus. The reason I know it is, you know, when I was in grade 10 English, we had this like hip English teacher who was sort of like, you know, by the day, you know, I'm going to teach you guys this David Copperfield crap. But, you know, at night, I'm going to turn you on to cool books like The Magus, which, you know, I remember is, you know, like... a minotaur running around a labyrinth trying to fuck a woman. That's what I remember from the magus. with all the scintillating steam that Michael Caine carries. I think I was 14 at the time. She's 14. Look, of course, we were attracted to these kind of things. Or maybe it was somebody else's idea to go see Pervert Games. I don't know. But, you know, according to Allo Police, that's the movie she was going to see. And that in itself is interesting, right? I'll tip things a little bit. A lot of the news stories about this case, about Teresa, they kind of fall all over themselves to to make sure everybody understands that Teresa was a good girl. And I have no reason to doubt that she, you know, that she was. But, you know, she went to camp. She's a student. She came home on time. You know, these photos of her first communion and things like this. You know, and as a family would, as a father would, you would paint that picture. So that when the news, like when the media drops in there, oh, and by the way, she's a great girl. Here's a picture of her communion. She went to see pervert games. Boom. Right. And it's never explained. But, you know, as a member of the public, of the French public, if you're reading Allo Police, right, on a Monday morning, and you see that, and it's just left there, right, for you to digest and move on, everybody knows what effect that's going to have. You're supposed to register that and kind of go, ah, okay. I know what that means. I know there might be more to the story here than is being told. But you're never really allowed or walked through how to digest it, right? So it's left to your own suspicion and rumor and imagination, without having a serious conversation, dialogue, or some kind of deconstruction about why that's important, why that is potentially important. And why we might want to consider that she went to see pervert games. It might be simply just a bunch of, you know, adolescent 14-year-olds kind of going, oh, that one looks good. And look, it's not rated R or 18 and above. For some reason, they've, you know, it's, or maybe it was, I couldn't find the rating on that. If somebody knows it, somebody out there knows the original rating on the film, the Magus. Let me know. Drop it in a chat or on Twitter or something like that. I'd be interested to know.
Anthony Quinn, Candice Bergen, Anna Karina. The game is real. The game is mystery. The game is love. The game is desire. The Magus. Rated R, restricted.
Well, there it is, right there. The Magus is rated R. Curiouser and curiouser. I'll say a few more things. I don't want to say too much at this point. Kind of just want to set the tables. You know, it's like one of those trips, you've ever done one of those where you just get in the car. Right. And you go, it's half planned. You're like, well, if I need something, I'll buy it along the way. It's kind of like that. So I just want to put the structure in motion and let people think about it a little bit before we really get into, okay, let's go from A to B, the autopsy, the blah, 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 blah. Let's not do that approach this time. We've done that. Let's try something different. I'm in the mood for something different. But one thing I think that is worth kind of looking at is just the, you know, the landscape of all of this. You know, where she lived, and where she went, and where she was found. They call it Montreal North. And when we've talked about Montreal North, we've talked about Cartierville and Ahuntsic, but that's Montreal North. It's not, there's an actual neighborhood called Montreal North, and it's way east. I think it's far more east than we've ever dealt with before. It's east of the Olympic Stadium, if that helps you, right? The only case I think that I recall that we talked about from over there is Valerie Daphne, who I believe was chopped up and found in cardboard boxes by the side of the road by a garbage man or something like that, in the 80s. So very, very east. In my recollection of this part of town, very poor, industrial, right? But Galerie d'Anjou, the mall, would have been a bright spot. So that mall was built in 68. So they go on September 69th. So very, very new. And, you know, with anchor shops like a Simpsons and an Eaton's. And, you know, we in the West Island, the West End of Montreal growing up in the 60s, had something I would imagine was similar called Fairview, with a Simpsons at one end, Eaton's on the other. And it was at that age. I mean, I wasn't in Montreal when I was 14, but I was there at 12 and 13. At that age, we'd go to the mall, right? And, you know, the Fairview had like a, you know, fountains and a statue of Zeus. So it was very ornate. And there was a movie theater attached that we'd go to. So that's where Teresa Martin is headed, this what would have been a Saturday evening. So it's Saturday night out. It's Saturday night of the movies, right? Her body's found the following early in the morning on Sunday. So you know, that's what you do at 14. It's a trip to the mall. And at the time, Galerie d'Anjou, it was big. It was much bigger than the Fairview Mall, although it was owned by the same company, by the Fairview Corporation. But when it opened, it was the second largest shopping mall in Canada, next to Yorkdale in Toronto. So it would have been a big thing, a big event, to be going there on a Saturday night. If in fact that's you know, that's where they're going. You know, we were rolling along there in the fall, and I think you know, one of the last sort of really kind of methodical podcasts I did was the one called Hyperthymesia, which was about, you know, we've done podcasts that were journeys, right? Car trips. And this one was about a bike ride, about me riding a bike. One of the things I mentioned in that hyperthymesia, by the way, is the condition of overthinking or obsessively thinking. So that's where that title came from. And so there was mentioned, you know, as a travelogue, the points along the way on my bike route. And you know, there's talk of farms and cows and tobacco sheds, but the one of the things I mentioned was an Airstream trailer, right? One of these 60s things, silver, you know, dome shaped, that I think I described as being covered in pine straw. Well, you know, that's still on my route. And on one of my rides recently, this is in the new year, I rode by one day and the door to the Airstream was open. Up until that point, it had been sealed, but it looked like for some reason the door had swung open. And, you know, I zipped by and thought, well, isn't that interesting? I wonder what it looks like inside. Right? And so then I'm like, should I look? Should I go inside? And I was like, I don't want to, you know, you gotta be careful about that kind of thing in North Carolina. You can get shot at for the slightest provocation, particularly when it has things to do with people's property rights. But the next day, I went out and it was overcast and it was morning. So not a lot of traffic, not a lot of people. And so I stopped and, you know, I had my cell phone, my camera. And I went up and I poked my head in. And, you know, as you'd expect, it's abandoned and mildewy with, you know, the remnants of, you know, a stove and like a bedroom area and a living area, another room. Well, I don't know if it's, you call it a room, but sacraments, you know, with the carpet torn up. And there's kind of like all that was left was that kind of green foam base. And I took a few pictures. I'll put those on the website. For kicks. But yeah, the door swung open. And then recently, just the other day, I drove by and somebody had taken like a large tree branch and propped it up against the door, you know, like it's sort of an angle to keep it shut. So the door closed. What I find disturbing about the Teresa Martin case is that I think everyone knows what happened. And I think they've always known what happened. And by everyone, I don't mean everyone, but I mean the media. I mean the police. I mean the coroner. But there's just this inertia to actually do anything about it. Because the age-old problem in Quebec is covering up for the unknown. You don't want to look too deeply because when you look under that rock, you may find yourself or right the footy prints of a former investigator or someone. Teresa Martin was collateral damage. She was really not that important in the grand scheme of things, and the game of cops and robbers that engaged the Montreal police in that era, not important at all. In fact, I would say that when they made these feeble attempts to investigate, they were not interested in solving her murder at all. They were interested in how that case could lead to assist them with other cops and robber matters, and that's just fact now. And this game of a cold case website is pure bullshit, completely. I sound like a broken record, but that they haven't solved anything. It's the same under 10 cases on that site. They keep adding cases as window dressing to tell everybody that you know they're being proactive. But that's a lot of horseshit. I'm not even going to debate that, and I don't even want anyone to. You know, I'm not asking somebody to prove me wrong or anything. I'm just telling you the fact. God help you if you fall on the other side of the law is my lesson and my advice. So with that, going out, read the French version on the way in. Going out, I'll read you, you know, at this point in time, if you go to traditional search engines and stuff, this is what these are the facts surrounding the Teresa Martin case. It says, in the evening of September 12th, 1969, Teresa Martin, 14 years old, was coming back from Galerie d'Anjou cinema by bus, accompanied by two friends. At the intersection of Boulevard Saint-Michel and Boulevard Henri Bourassa, Teresa left her friends to take a transfer. Around 3 a.m., her body was found in a sitting position in the parking lot of the Vieux Cypress Tavern on Boulevard Henri Bourassa. The young victim had been carefully placed there by the suspects. Any information, blah, 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 call the Sûreté de Québec at blah, blah, blah. And what I'd like to know is why in that notification the police left off the most interesting and telling part of that discovery. That she was found with a tattoo carved, newly carved, on her stomach that read, FL, Frenchie, I love you. This is who killed Teresa. Some housekeeping to close us out. Please consider, if you like the podcast, giving us a favorable rating. Just do 5 stars. What the hell? On iTunes, Apple Podcasts, that platform, or anywhere, I don't care. Social media, you can follow us on Twitter at Teresa Lore, at TheresaAllore. There's the website that I've mentioned twice. I don't need to say it again. If you go to the website, you can kind of find your way to everything from the Twitter account to the Facebook page, which is like Teresa Lore, the podcast or something. You can order a book there. Wish You Were Here, the book I wrote with Patricia Pearson. Publishing pending in other countries. Everything is still constipated due to COVID. So if you want to book, the fastest way is just to order it from my website, and I'll even put my John Henry on it, and I'll say something personal and nice if that's what you want. Or, you know, if you want to protect the value of it to resale it, I'll just sign it, right? Whatever your pleasure. I will certainly abide by your opportunistic needs. So there's that. I think the podcast is about, if it isn't already, it's going to be launched on Amazon Podcasts pretty soon. I can test it. Let's try it right now. I have an Alexa, because I ordered one so I can talk to my mom. Alexa, play Who Killed Teresa podcast.
Sorry, I don't know that one. You can ask me to recommend a podcast.
No, I'm good. Alexa, Who was Teresa Allure?
Here's something I found on the web. According to Wikipedia.org,
yeah.
Teresa is a Mattel fashion doll who is marketed as one of Barbie's fictional friends.
All right. We'll revisit that later. CrimeCon, UK. It's the crime convention has been moved. It is no longer in June. It has been pushed back until September, which is fine by me. I get three more months of publicity. Got no problem with it. If we get together in September, I'll be sure to come to London with a bag of books. How's that? That's all I got. We'll continue talking about the Teresa Martin case. I don't know for how long, for a while. Next time, for this time, this has been Who Killed Teresa. I'm John Allure, your host, and have yourselves a great, great day. Where ships come home to die, no lofty peak, no fortress bold could match our captain's eye. Yeah.